Good morning, children. Welcome back to class. Today I am going to tell a story to you. Okay? Listen, children. Patty, a milkmaid, milked her cow and had two full pails of fresh, creamy milk. She put both the pails of milk on a stick and set off to the market to sell the milk. As she took steps towards the market, her thoughts took steps towards wealth. On her way, she kept thinking about the money she would make from selling the milk. Then she thought about what she would do with that money. She was talking to herself and said, "Once I get the money, I'll buy a chicken. And the chicken will lay eggs and I will get more chicken. They'll all lay eggs and I will sell them for more money. Then I'll buy the house on the hill and everyone will envy me." She was very happy that soon she would be very rich. With these happy thoughts, She marched forward, but suddenly she tripped and fell. Both the pails of milk fell and all her dreams were shattered. The milk split on the ground and what Patty could do was all but cry. "No more dreams," she cried foolishly. Now the moral of the story is, don't count your chicken before they hatch. Thank you, children.
Today we are going to revise the topic population and settlement. You remember, children, we learnt it some months ago, population and settlement. That lesson we are going to revise today, okay? And what are we going to revise in that lesson is, we are going to revise about population, the races in general, and then the races in India, the religions and the languages spoken in India, settlements, and we are also going to learn about old house types. Now, as I already told you, children, population geography is a study which includes the mortality rate and then the natality rate and the growth rate, etc. These three terms are new to you, no? So I am going to tell you what these terms are. Okay, now what is natality? Natality is the birth rate within a population. And what is mortality? Mortality is the principles concerning what is good and bad or what is right or wrong. Growth rate, you all know already, you know. Growth rate is the rate at which something grows. Now, what is migration, children? Have you heard about migration before? I think you would have learnt in your earlier classes, no? People moving from place to place in search of food or shelter is called as migration, okay? What is migration? People moving from place to place in search of food and shelter is called as migration. Now, I will revise about the races, okay? Biological grouping within the human species is called as a race. Biological grouping within a species is called as a race. The race is a group of people with more or less permanent distinguishing characters that are inherited from their parents. Okay. Now, human racial types are mostly based on visual traits. Visual means what we see. Okay. So, human racial types are mostly based on visual traits. What are the visual traits, children? Head shape, the facial features, nose shape, eye color and shape, and then the skin color, and then stature. We already revised about, we have learnt about all that before, no? So these are the visual traits, okay? Now, the major world human races are Caucasoids, that is Europeans, Negroids, Africans, Mongoloids are from Asia, and Australoids are from Australia. Okay, we will revise one by one in detail. Now, first about Caucasoids. Okay, you know who Caucasoids are, no? It is also known as the European race because the Caucasoids are mostly found in Europe only. These people have fair skin. They have dark brown eyes. Then they have very wavy hair and normal nose. They are also found in Eurasia. I told you what Eurasia is, no, in the class we studied. Okay, so Caucasoids are also known as the European race. These people have fair skin, they have dark brown eyes, they have wavy hair, and they have a narrow nose. Okay, and next is Negroid. The Negroids, they have dark eyes, they have dark skin, they have black woolly hair in curls, and then they have a wide nose, they have a long head, and they have thick lips. All of you would have seen a Negro, no? You all know. So, they live in different parts of Africa. They are the descendants of the people of the sub-Saharan Africa. Okay. Now, out of the topic, I am telling you something. We should no longer call anyone a Negro. Okay. Because when we use the word Negro, it is connected with racism, colonialism, and slavery. So we can no longer use the word Negro. It becomes a crime if we use the word Negro. Okay. Next, we are going to learn about the Mongoloids. This race is commonly called as the Asian American race, and the features of the Mongoloids are they have light yellow color, or they also have brown skin. They have straight hair. They have a flat nose. They have a broad head, and they have a medium nose. Okay, they are found in Asia and the Arctic regions. Next is the Australoids. Australoids have wide nose. They have curly hair. They have dark skin. They are short in height. They live in Australia and Asia. Historians suggest that there were some Australoid tribes in India, but now the new studies have revealed that there is no Australoid ancestry in India at all. Okay, in the former days historians were saying that the Australoids lived in India also, but now studies have showed us that there is no Australoid ancestry in India. Next, we will revise about the races of India. India is said to be one of the cradle lands of human civilization. The ancient Indus Valley civilization is said to have been of Dravidian origin in North India. Okay, the Dravidians were pushed south when the Indo-Aryans came in later. So, South India was dominated by the Dravidian kingdoms, namely the Cheras, the Cholas and Pandyas. You have already learnt about them. You have learnt about the Cheras, the Cholas and Pandyas. So, South India was dominated by the Dravidian kingdoms, namely Cheras, Cholas and Pandyas. And the Dravidian languages were Tamil, Telugu, Kannadam, Malayalam and Tulu. Okay. Almost all the Dravidians, they lived in the southern part of India only. Most of the Dravidians lived in the southern part of India only. Next, we will revise about religion. What is religion, children? You all know what is religion, and you also know what religion you belong to also know. So, religion means a particular system of faith and worship. It is a symbol of group identity. You all know, Christians, Hindus, Muslims, they are all grouped together. Okay. Now, how do we classify religion? We already learned the classification of religion. The first one is universalizing religion, that is Christianity, Islam and Buddhism. Universalizing religions are Christianity, Islam and Buddhism. Then ethnic religions. The ethnic religions are Judaism, Hinduism and Japanese. Then what are the tribal religions, children? We learnt about it also, no? Animism, Shamanism and Shaman. You remember? And then we learnt about the worship places. You all know the worship places now, no? I think you will all be thorough because you wrote the test also. So, Buddhists will worship in a vihara. The Christians will worship in a church. Hindus will worship in a temple. Muslims in a mosque. The Jains will worship in a basadia, and the people belonging to Judaism will worship in a synagogue. Okay. These are the worship places where people worship. Next, we will revise about languages. Language is a great form of socialization. I already told you this, no? It's a great form of socialization. The most common type of communication of language is in the oral form, or it is in the written form. Okay. Now, what does language promote, children? Language promotes transmission of ideas and the functioning of political, economical, social and religious systems. So, we are going into the languages of India. India has got many languages and cultures. Each state has its own language, though the national language is said to be Hindi and English. We believe that Hindi is the national language, but it is not so. Hindi and English are official languages, and we have 22 major languages which are spoken in India. How many languages, children, are spoken in India? About 22 languages are spoken in India. Okay. Now, India follows Kashmiri, Urdu, Punjabi, Hindi, Rajasthani, Gujarati, Bengali, Assamese in North India. In South India, the main languages of the Dravidian family, Tamil, Telugu, Kannadam, Malayalam are spoken. But today, the usage of language has changed. It is often used as a communication skill nowadays. That is why, children, we keep on telling you to speak in English in school. In school, always the rule of our school is that no, we should speak only in English. We cannot speak in Tamil. This is the only reason we are very particular that you all learn and speak good English, because now English has become a communicational skill. Okay. Next, we are going to learn about settlement, children. We have already learned settlement, no? So you all know what settlement is. I'm revising again. Just listen, okay? Settlement is a place where people live and interact through activities such as agriculture, through trading, and through environment. And there are two types of settlements. You know that the first one is an urban settlement, and the second one is a rural settlement. So first, we'll see about the urban settlement. An urban settlement engages in activities such as industries, trade, and banking. Okay. A rural settlement, which will involve in agriculture, lumbering, fishing, and mining. Remember, we learned what lumbering is. We already learned, no, what lumbering is. You asked me what is lumbering, and I told you what is lumbering also. Okay. So now, rural settlements, they have a small population and they have a low population density. But an urban settlement has a large population and they have a high population density. That is the difference between an urban and a rural settlement. Okay. First difference is what they trade. The urban settlement, it involves in activities such as industries, trade, and banking. Rural settlement is involving agriculture, lumbering, fishing, and mining. And then the next difference is rural settlement will have a small population and it will have a low population density. And urban settlement will have a high population and a high population density. Next, we will learn about old house types. Okay. First, we learn about old house types. You have already seen the picture of old houses, no? When you go to your villages or you see in the movies also, you can see old house types. Okay. In the early periods of human settlement, houses were built using the local materials only. The form of the house was closely related to the environment. In the agricultural regions, houses were built with mud walls, and the roof was made out of the stalks of paddy or grass or whatever crop they grew. And local wood was used to form the framework of the house, framework of the roof. Okay. Old house types, they have wide verandas and they have an open air circulation. The size of the house will depend upon the economic status of the inhabitants who live in it. Okay. So the old house type, it can be big or it can be small depending upon the economic status of the inmates. That is all for the revision of this lesson today, children. We will continue in the next class. Okay.
Our assignment for today's lesson is, children, you have to write it in your 120 pages rule notebook, which is a social notebook. You will write about 10 lines about which language do you like other than your mother tongue and why do you like that language. Okay. I expect all of you to write your test and take your Kahoots, children. Take care. Thank you and bye.